I can't feel the heat until you hold your hand over the flame. You have to cross the line just to remember where it lays. You won't know your worth now, son, until you take a hit. And you won't find the beat until you lose yourself in it.
Hi and welcome to Brainstorm, Saskatchewan's only skeptical podcast where we talk about news, politics, science, and religion in a fun and skeptical way. This is episode 10, recorded on May 17th, 2014. I'm Corey, and with me tonight I've got Raz, Mike, Destin, and special guest David Richards from the Center for Inquiry, Regina Branch. Okay, so I guess we might as well just start asking Dave about the CFI.
All right.
Who's this guy?
David Richards from the CFI.
There you go.
Well, I can sort of go into the basics. Any questions you guys have, that's probably the easiest way. I don't know what's of most interest, but I guess speaking generally, CFI can refer to both the Regina CFI, the Canadian one, as well as the international one. CFI Transnational or International was a group founded many years ago in the U.S., and there's a Canadian branch of it that's affiliated but not directly linked to it. Two sort of main functions or goals of the CFI. The first is to provide a sense of community, belonging, fill some of the social aspects that religion can sometimes fill for people who are skeptics, agnostics, atheists, etc.
And so I always thought one of the best things about being an atheist was I got my Sundays off.
Well, you get your Sundays off, but you also sometimes miss out on some of the social stuff. So we don't necessarily do the same thing as a church. Ours is a little bit less formal. So our Sundays will involve getting together at a pub and watching Cosmos. So that's more fun. We've got an arrangement where we can go have all you can eat tacos and other various delectable delights and watch Cosmos and discuss philosophy and skepticism and all that. And we'll, once Cosmos is done, we'll sort of return back to our skeptics in the pub, get together. So it's an opportunity to, get together with like-minded individuals, hang out, drink a few pints, talk about philosophy, talk about not just sort of skeptical topics, but have that sort of sense of community where you know you're not going to all of a sudden out of nowhere be blindsided by someone who wants to convert you to something.
And when do you sacrifice the baby to Satan?
We have never once yet done that. I'm not
saying...
Well,
you're just not a very good atheist.
I'm not saying it hasn't happened.
But you eat them, right? That's where the taco feeling comes from.
That is... Did you guys know where that sort of myth of the atheist baby eating comes from?
Yeah.
I'm totally off topic here.
Is that a real myth?
That's a real myth.
Entire podcast, man.
Sweet.
It's all off topic.
So I've
been breaking the law the whole time.
I was actually really puzzled by this once. Where does this idea that atheists eat babies come from? And this sort of crazy idea that atheists eat babies. And it's all over the internet. I've heard the accusation from religious people, and I thought, okay, I'm going to try and figure it out. And it's actually not an accusation. It's a threat. It actually comes right from the Bible, and it's not, oh, you atheist, you're so bad, you eat babies. It's, the punishment for atheism is you're going to spend eternity in hell being forced to eat your own children and knowing that that's what you're going to do.
That's interesting.
And that's the appropriate level of punishment.
Well, I don't have that many children. I'm pretty sure I could get through them in a couple of weeks.
It was just one of those ones like, oh, this doesn't
eternity.
This doesn't make us look bad. This makes the people writing this crazy story look bad.
So I spend eternity eating barbecue veal?
Are you a cow?
Well, some of them said.
I guess I don't want to go there.
Yeah, I didn't want to say anything, man. But
I'm new here.
Type of veal.
So, going back to before I got sidetracked there. So the first one of the two areas of focus for the CFI is providing that sort of sense of community, that social outlet. The other one is to provide a source of advocacy, science education, provide a voice for arguing for secularism, skepticism within public discourse.
Hey, you got your religion on my policy.
Yeah, separation of church and state. So, you know, providing that voice for people who really want to take the approach of being fighting for a secular society. For me, I try and look at that element and almost split that into as well, and this sort of, you won't find this necessarily in CFI official policy doctrine or anything like that, but I can often look at that advocacy element and sort of see it split into two groups, and one is the fight for secularism, in which case the CFI will take an active role in fighting for public policy that has the separation of church and state, the supremacy of fact and reality-based science in schools, and really take a strong stand on that. And we do feel that the government should actively separate itself from a specific religious mandate. But on the second side of it as well is not so much a matter of fighting for public policy, but just public discourse. And that's when we start getting more into actually arguing for skepticism and even atheism and agnosticism to some degree. Not that in any way, shape, or form do we feel that the government should enforce that, but that we want to have a voice for that argument in the public discourse. So one of the things we will do and have done in Regina is there was a psychic come to town. I'm not going to advertise for him by going into the name, but a number of our
members.
Was it
the Amazing Ravine?
It was not the Amazing Ravine. He's at least an entertainer. I guess technically these other guys are entertainers as well. But the type of psychic
I like
that.
Grief vampires.
Yeah, more like grief vampires showing up and bilking people of their money. And so basically we weren't hostile or antagonistic towards him. But what we did do is have a number of our members go to the venue where people were showing up and just hand out flyers that were educational for it. At no point would we ever argue that the government should outlaw people from believing this stuff, because I don't think that would be really in line with.
Did you seed the audience?
We didn't seed the audience. We were pretty sure he did, but no.
You gotta troll the shit out of people.
Well, we talked to him. He actually came out and talked to our members outside and invited some people in. And it was, again, it remained very civil. Mm. But similar to that, and we'll take a similar approach with religion and things like that. Not that we're outside of churches handing out flyers or anything, but, we'll make the argument and present our case for what we believe. But in my own mind, I find that it's important to keep, at least from a standpoint of tactics or strategy or where we come from, those two sort of streams of thought very different. When it comes to separating church and state, that we will argue that the government should step in and actively separate church and state. The court should step in and say, no, city halls should not have Christian prayer at the beginning, because that's not equally balanced. Whereas it comes to what people's personal beliefs are, certainly in no way, shape, or form do we want the government telling people they're not allowed to be Christian or not allowed to believe in homeopathy or not allowed to do whatever they want, you know, spin in a circle four times and wish that it dreams away cancer.
Being not allowed to believe in it is one thing, but allowing someone to make money off of fleecing the population sounds like something that deserves to be fought against.
What was it? Fruad?
Fraud.
Oh, fraud. Thank you.
Fraud. And again, yeah.
He's only functioning a retard. Sorry.
Which I think at that point is that I would argue that it makes sense that the laws that are in place that cause all of the online and television psychics or whatever to have the disclaimers that say this is for entertainment purposes only. Yep. you know, that's fair. But if once they're doing that, once they are actively, you know, disclaiming that this is for entertainment purposes only, I personally don't feel there should be sort of a government coming in and telling people what they can and can't believe. Because
well, the grand scheme of things,
we're going to end up on the wrong end of that one as soon as the government starts doing that.
But homeopathy isn't for entertainment purposes only. That's the
no, don't get me wrong. When it comes to things like homeopathy, I would advocate for labels and saying that basically have warning labels that say, no, science says ingredient. This is water.
Yeah.
this is, you are drinking something from a tap. Again, though.
But it's been shook and like banged against a leather.
It's been diluted a million times. We've taken this water and diluted it with more water. But again, I think one of the roles we fill there is the education piece, trying to get out into the public, trying to present the case. And again, the advocacy piece, it just comes down to making sure that we're presenting our case very differently in those two circumstances, where the circumstance on one hand is someone forcing me to believe their beliefs. Then again, I'm gonna fight very loudly to say, no, I want intervention on this to prevent someone else's beliefs from being mandated on me. When it just comes down to what other people believe, I don't want to then be a hypocrite and say, well, no, just because I'm right, I think the government should enforce my beliefs. What I think there is at that point, let's let the case speak for itself. I think in the grand scheme of things, when all is said and done, it may not feel like it in the short term, but I think education is going to eventually win that fight over the people, you know, who are advocating for homeopathy.
We're all kind of just shaking our heads.
Anti-vaxxers, yeah. and all of those other
so,
things.
So doesn't translate in sound, but yeah, everybody kind of agrees.
Have to be.
Yeah.
What would you say, in your opinion, CFI's stance would be on people to take a more direct approach directly against government, like in the U.S. where the Church of Satan is preparing that big giant statue? That's
yes,
the name
yeah,
of the group.
That's right.
The irony is that they didn't put up a statue of Satan. They put up a statue of Baphomet. Instead.
Right.
They didn't even get their own god right. because
did I actually say statue of Satan? I thought I just said giant statue.
I think that whole thing is just obviously very tongue-in-cheek.
Yes. Yeah.
maybe Baphomet's just more, I don't know, photogenic.
Yeah. I think that's it's similar
Satan's
to the whole
got like an ugly,
you know,
mole
flying spaghetti monster point of view. Is it's an argument from absurdity, right? It's mm-hmm. you show how absurd the other side's art, and I don't mean view the other side.
What I mean is the level that they're planning to take it to, because they've received enough funding.
Yeah,
that they're actually going to turn the original statue into a mold.
Yeah,
and just pump them out, and anywhere that they see religious propaganda on any government property, they're just going to set one up.
I don't know if that's necessarily the most productive approach. I think I agree with the sentiment behind it. The idea that if there's going to be a religious statue on government property, that it be open to any type of religious statue.
Well, clearly, if all religions are going to start putting up monuments on all government property, the government's going to need more property for starters.
That's right.
That whole point of, I guess, that whole situation is going to be flawed from the beginning, because I think they got a certain degree of momentum this one time to get that one statue. If who gets to put their statue is based on who can afford to pay for it, we're going to have a lot more Christian statues. If state religion gets determined by the pocketbook, I think you're going to find that Christian groups are going to shell out the cash for putting up their statues to a much, much greater degree than those who of really any other religion in North America. So I think the problem with it, I think it's an interesting publicity stunt, and I think it's, if it isn't enough for people, and I've seen it in the past where there have been groups that have done similar approaches, and what happens is the city caves and goes back to what the secularists wanted in the first place, which is not having religion state-sponsored. It's a win.
Well, that's the entire purpose, right?
But what comes down, what will start happening is eventually the Christian groups or the politicians that they support are going to call their bluff. And eventually, I think the Satanist groups are going to, or the secularist groups who put up flying spaghetti monster statues or what have you, are going to run out of steam, right? I'm pretty passionate about fighting for the separation of church and state. But I don't know if, how do I put this? I don't know if I would spend my money in that way to that degree. I'd rather.
Yeah, you're not likely to get much of a return on your investment.
Yeah, right. Where it, like, and it's, you have people who are devoutly religious feel that charitable giving for a religious cause is charity. If the money they spend on their pastor and their church and proselytizing others into their own faith, they view that as charity. I don't know if a lot of atheists would think that way. I know for me, I'll spend money on supporting the CFI and fighting for secularism. However, I still put that into a different category than money that I donate for actual
right, it's
helping
not cancer
people.
Research.
Yeah. So and again, maybe scientific research I would consider that, but even real scientific research and real scientific charities still aren't necessarily advocating for atheism. And I'm sure there's many theists who are on the receiving end of that type of charity as well. And again, I'll sort of do the plug for the CFI. We've recently done a number of fundraisers and charitable giving where we've taken the step back and said, you know what, we need to put our money where our mouth is. When we say you can be good without God, when we say that, you know, atheists can give to the community and do it. So we made a fairly substantial fundraiser for the Radiothon. Contributed about a little over $1,600 to the Children's Hospital on behalf of the CFI. We do a scholarship for the Regina Science Fair. So we do a $200 bursary that goes towards the one of the recipients, a prize recipient within the Science Fair. So we'll look at diluting, quote unquote, our charitable giving to things that actually help people. Whereas
what
I think
really
you're going
to
find
it matters that you're not sitting in a big golden throne while you say that.
Yeah. Yeah, chairs
right.
are comfortable
with
though,
your special hat.
Yeah,
you guys
good.
Have a pretty nice studio.
It's
here.
All about the special hat.
Well, also with the church.
Yeah, it's all
Dave who has the nice studio.
Okay, fair enough. Thank you, Dave.
And the church obviously would not hesitate to put it up themselves on government property because it's just advertising.
Yeah, and I don't know it. I sometimes question how effective the in-your-face, a really, really aggressive approach it will be, you know.
It never is effective.
I'm not sure. Like, I think there's value in both.
If someone comes to believing right. that sort of stuff through faith or what have you, reason isn't going to lead them out of it.
It depends on who you're trying to convince, right? It's you're never going to convince Ken Ham. But what you might do is convince the 17-year-old liberal Christian who's watching, right?
Yep.
It's who is the target audience?
The best outcome I feel of any sort of discourse with some sort of woo believer is make them think.
Yeah.
They'll convince themselves. Yep. That's the only way it will actually stick.
For sure. And again, I to some extent I think the aggressive approach maybe helps the more moderate approach by coexisting. You compare things back to civil rights. Would the message of Martin Luther King been as effective had Malcolm X not been around? Had you not had the aggressive, scary guy there, how would the moderate, tolerant guy have been taken? And I think not to necessarily say they are on the same level, but when you have the scary atheists out there, sometimes I don't know if that helps or hinders.
Well,
what
does a scary atheist look
well,
like?
Well,
the scary
atheists
put satanic statues on front lawns of government buildings, right?
I was actually just picturing them knocking on people's doors and asking them if they're atheists, and if they say no or yes, dragging them off and getting confessions out of them in a basement while they're being tortured.
And I don't mean scary to me. I mean the atheists that
Dave
are frightening
Silverman
to the moderate.
On you know, he goes on Fox News and he's the scary atheist. He's the president of American Atheists, and you know, he's the guy.
He's pretty in your face.
Yeah. And he's always the guy who advocates that firebrand atheist is the best way to do it. He really thinks that if we aren't in your face, then nobody's going to ever be convinced. But I think it takes all kinds.
Well, he's up against Southern Baptists.
Yeah, well, that's...
You get your Asher Solos as well. I you know, before the podcast started, his name came up when we were talking about sort of some of the atheists in the Saskatchewan atheist community.
Yeah.
I think he's the quintessential sort of scary atheist out there. He's the one that all the talk radio, you know, John Gormley wheels him out when he wants to show how scary the atheists are and how close-minded they are.
Yeah.
He's the guy that gets wheeled out to just to sort of put on display. They're not going to bring out sort of the reasonable, tolerant guy to talk on the radio. They bring out the guy that they want to show is, you know, off his rocker. So.
Yeah,
that's funny because I wheel out John Gormley when I want to make a point about scary people.
Yeah, when I want to point out how off your rocker
this is Saskatchewan's
are.
Rush Limbaugh. Yeah.
He didn't used to be. That's the scary thing about it.
No, he used to be real centered.
It's interesting to watch the polarization over the years. I used to listen to him all the time. It was probably from 15 years ago to about 10 years ago. There was a 5-year window where I worked in a role where I could have the radio on in the background in the mornings, and I would pretty much always have him on. And he seemed like a moderate, still on the right wing, but I stopped listening for about 8-9 years, and I come back and I was like, holy crap, this guy's gone insane.
Yeah.
It was again sort of before the recording started, we were talking about certainty, and I think that's part of the problem is he's fallen prey to that idea of being certain about so much. And I think it speaks to a lot of the same problems that, religion brings to the world. And to some extent, he's certain about his religion as well, but he's certain about so many things.
I stopped listening to him when he started saying, like, people would compare him to Fox News.
Yeah.
And he started saying, well, that's not a bad thing. Yeah.
Well, I think his own advertising. His own advertising, I think, speaks to the biggest problem that I have with him, because one of the things they actually advertise him now is that he doesn't change his mind on anything. And I'm like, okay, if that's what you're bragging about, if you're proud of the fact that you cannot change your mind in light of new evidence and when new facts become available, you're gone, right?
Well,
that's the point at which.
And his show, there used to be discourse where he would actually have conversations with people that called in. And now if you call in and you disagree with him, he'll just hang up on you and go to the next caller.
Yeah.
So the show is basically completely a John Gormley masturbatory show where everybody agrees with him or they don't get to call in.
That's right.
There's one old face I don't want to see.
Yeah. No, I used to listen to him quite a bit, like you say, but over the years, he's just gotten more and more extreme. Or maybe I've gotten more and more liberal.
Well, that's definitely the case.
Yeah.
I don't know if I have, and I find him more extreme, too. I think I might be less liberal than I was. No, I'm liberal in different ways.
Oh, shit. I had a question way earlier, and I forgot.
Should go back
about
to
it.
CFI stuff. I'll see if I can pitch for us.
Something about CFI.
Well, I can do a bit of the sales pitch here.
Sure.
So
I was just zoning on certainty.
Yeah. if people do want to get more information about the CFI, probably the best way to find out about us, at least as far as the Regina side of things go, if you go into Facebook and just do a search for CFI and Regina, we'll pop up. You can get in touch with CFI National as well. So if someone listens to this podcast from outside of Regina, they can find local chapters as well.
Are you on the Twitters and the MySpaces?
We do have a Twitter, and I have to apologize. I don't have our Twitter handle off the top of my head.
Yeah,
but for people who are not on Facebook or social media, regina@cficanada.ca is the email address. So if anyone wants to get in touch with us or find out more information, they can email regina@cficanada.ca and we can pass on more information that way. Like I said, most of the communication that happens, I think, probably happens through Facebook. There's a meetup page as well. I'm not on that one, so I don't know a lot about it. But
Corey will also put all the links right on our website.
Sure.
Thank you.
I just volunteered him to do that.
Yeah, the Twitter is actually just at CFI.
Perfect.
Regina, so.
Corey's more on the ball
no
than I am.
No scores or dots or
no, it's just straight up at sign.
Hashtag.
I didn't see any hashtags.
And even if it's just a matter of someone wants to come out and watch Cosmos.
Hashtag in your name.
You know, watch Cosmos with a group of people. You know, they don't have to get heavily involved. You don't have to do any of the other stuff. We're pretty open to sort of any level of involvement or participation people want. And
there's really no other stuff. I mean, I've come out to Darwin Day. I've come out to watch meteor showers with you guys.
That's pretty romantic, actually.
Yeah, it's very romantic.
Yeah.
It was pretty cool.
Science. But like, if people do want to do science. More.
My ADD kicked in on the meteor thing. But
sure.
But yeah, we do have bigger, like you mentioned, Darwin Day. We do have bigger events. We try and do an annual Darwin Day event. We're looking at doing a sort of a big summer barbecue as well. Cool. A number of events that way, fundraisers we're hoping to continue to support the Regina Science Fair fundraiser that way. And we did a big magic and comedy show recently. Yeah. That was the fundraiser for the Radiothon. Yeah. You know, anyone who wants to join in for any of that stuff is more than welcome, but even if it's just a matter of you want to come out and have a beer and, you know, talk about religion and philosophy in a non-podcast setting, it's a great place to come and do that.
So there are non-podcast settings to do this stuff.
Yeah, it's basic. From what you've told me about your podcast, basically it's that, but I was about to say more beer, probably an equal amount, but just spread out over several hours.
Right.
But there's people there.
But more
it's
people.
It's outside.
Yeah.
Not
and
in.
It's
what
even the advocacy part of it has been fun because we've on a number of occasions had servers join the group or at least get more information about what we're doing just because they've been out and about. They hand someone a beer and say, "What did I just overhear you guys talking about?" And join
cool.
in the conversation and get invited that way. So
that's very cool.
It's been fun. Any sort of other questions about CFI? I can
so
field?
Remember, convert your waitress.
Yeah.
Waitress.
Not a big fan of converting, educating, providing information.
Explain to her that even though we share a common ancestor with monkeys, they're still bartenders.
Yeah. I'm shaking my head. That doesn't come across over the radio.
Yeah.
And I should also say, too, that just because we are a group that supports secularism and skepticism, it's not exclusive to agnostics and atheists. One of the things that I found very interesting, and I don't know how common this is outside of Regina, but we have a number of people who are theists as well within the group, and
which is shocking, kind of.
Well, there's a lot of moderates out there, right? And it's that I was talking about how there's the two different elements, and creating a safe space is important. So we don't want, and I say safe space, not that we can't protect ourselves.
God, they're attacking my ideas.
I've got privilege coming out my, you know what. So I'm a walking safe space, but, it's still a matter of we don't want people coming out and saying, "You guys are all a bunch of idiots." But at the same time, we have a number of people who are religious themselves who on the Facebook group will enter into a discussion and say, okay, here is that other perspective, but they tend to be the so-called kissing fish Christians, right? The ones that have the Darwin and the Darwin fish and the Christian fish at the same time.
It's an interesting term. I don't believe I've heard
that. The kissing fish Christian. Yeah. It came out of the Darwin fish symbol and the Christian fish symbol kissing each other, believing in both the pro-evolution Christians.
Right.
But like we have,
so the accepting reality Christians,
the ones that accept reality. But we have a woman
but
in the group.
What to add to it?
A woman in the group who is Muslim. We have
this is good. But I'm going to add this.
Who self-identifies as Wiccan? And again,
we have one of those in the Weyburn atheist group.
Yeah. Perfect. Yeah. But again, I think it comes down to how you approach it, right? And I think if someone gets comfort and support from the symbolism of it and recognizes that this is a
there's such a thing as cultural theists, right?
Or even like if we kicked out or didn't allow anyone who believed in any sort of woo, we'd probably end up pretty small, I think, because everyone has their own I don't know, I say biases or blind spots, or and I'm sure I do too.
Absolutely.
if nothing else, I think the Riders are a better football team than the other teams. And that's obviously not that's a bias, right?
Like it's definitely they sports always pretty hard. But sometimes the other team sports harder.
But again, the human brain likes joining up with teams, really want right? to win. So yeah. we like we're a very a cliquish brain. So if someone thinks that acupuncture has properties beyond placebo effect or other elements that way, and they want to join in, we'll talk about it and we'll have debates and arguments.
It's interesting, yeah.
Right. So if we're going to do that for some of the non-religious types of woo, it would only make sense that we do the same thing for people who are religious. Again, I think someone who believes in literalist creationism would not enjoy being a member and wouldn't fit in.
Yeah, wouldn't at all.
But well, unless they got to wear one of those jester's hats.
Yeah. But like, there's a lot of Christians out there who believe just as strongly in the separation of church and state.
Yep.
At the end of the day, secularism benefits religious people as much as it does atheists, because it's sure. just a matter of
if only
you know,
more
who's
of
on
them
top
knew
currently.
That.
Yeah.
So is tithing required?
There is no tithing required. No, none.
One bushel
don't get
of grain, one goat.
Don't get me wrong. We have a donation bucket.
Absolutely.
A bushel of grain and a goat?
And there's no guilt for the cosmos because there's, you know, it is a meal. There's a $10 entry fee for the food.
So I get all the tacos I want for $10.
I think. Oh, I'm going to get in trouble if
that's
I misquote
ridiculous.
The price.
Whoa, hey, fat guys, come to us. Watch Cosmos. Oh, you eat tacos
every day.
And it's not. I will point out it hasn't always been tacos. There's been other. We've had various other foods that have been provided, but. Yeah, so stuff like that
like
we obviously
babies.
Have a door fee for.
babies.
No eating
Let it
babies.
Go.
It's okay. Corey will edit all my crap out.
Okay, don't perfect. We did a big Festivus dinner, which again, there was a thing. It was $35 a plate or $40 a plate, depending on
Did you do
like,
the airing of grievances
we did,
after?
Excellent. The airing nice. Of grievances. We didn't do the feats of strength.
No?
No. Oh. Our president would not allow anyone to wrestle him. I nominated him as the head of the household, but that didn't happen.
Who's your president?
Kaylin Christensen.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Cool.
Apparently everyone here knows him.
Well,
we've
sort
met.
Of. Yeah, we've
okay,
met.
Perfect.
Exactly.
So Kaylin would not allow anyone to wrestle him, but we did do airing of grievances. We had the Festivus poll. That was a good time. And so some events will have like a cover charge, but most will just pass the bucket around. And again, that will go to various things like, you know, paying for the scholarship fund and paying for Darwin Day, things like that. So some events will be fundraisers and other events will purely be education oriented and try and use the fundraisers to pay for those ones.
Sure.
So I got a question about, I guess it's the logistics of the CFI Regina.
Yep.
I was led to believe that it's not an official branch of the Canadian CFI.
We are now. We have an official email. We're part of that. We're sort of slowly but surely getting amalgamated within to the national group.
Perfect.
We're like a splinter cell.
Well, there's
we're a mega cult.
There's always different opinions. Any time you have any
not
national organization.
Not a terrorist organization.
Not terrorists.
Anti-cult.
No. Anytime you have any big national organization, there's going to be different levels of centralization and decentralization, and it sort of ebbs and flows. I think it's doing a very good job of finding that balance that still keeps a common message. While at the same time allowing individual groups to focus on areas of interest within their local community. The Saskatoon group had been been around for a lot longer than the Regina group. So we sort of bred from them. The Regina chapter started when the Science Center was doing had a presentation or a workshop on ghosts, and not like, hey, here's some of the psychological science behind why people believe in ghosts. It was actually a, here's the science of ectoplasm.
That's oh not a God. Real thing.
And, really? a number of people said, hey, this is inappropriate for a science museum to be doing. So we reached out to...
I didn't hear about that.
This would have been about 5 years ago now.
Okay.
And we actually had one of our early members be like, who was working there at the time, and sort of reached out to the Saskatoon group and said, look, this is what's going on. I want to do something about this. So brought sort of, that was sort of the first initial impetus for it. Mm-hmm. And it sort of grew from there. The first event I ever went to was just it was really just a discussion. By this point, we're actually meeting at the Science Center, ironically.
Ironically, I don't know. It's,
well, the fact that it was originally brought in to deal with something Science Center was doing.
Right.
I actually think I know the director of the Science Center.
Yeah.
So We can turn that in. I can bring her in and have a big potato tape.
You know what? I don't even know. I wasn't part of the group at the time, so this is myth and legend of our origin story. The very first group I went to was a friend of mine at the time. Was involved in the bringing of them to Regina. The group had been around for a few months, and it was Christmas, probably, I can't remember if it was 4 years ago or 5 years ago. Basically just put out a call that said, we're going to have this group get a little bit of a get together. There'll be cookies, there'll be tea, and we're going to talk about being atheist over the holidays, and just a discussion group on how that relates. How involved are some people with some of the cultural elements of Christmas? And it was just that really spoke to me as someone who was like, I love the holidays. I love the cultural elements of Christmas and a lot of the social elements of it. So for me, it was like, all right, I'm curious as to how other people navigate this. Because I had only really been an atheist for a couple of years at that point. And I was interested to hear how other people sort of went down that road. So for me, that was a great opportunity to show up and meet with like-minded individuals. And then just sort of went from there. Early on, a lot of our meetings were simply things like that. We would get together in a boardroom somewhere and shoot the shit for a while. And we had a couple movie nights. We watched Religious once. We had a viewing of that where we all got together and watched it and then had a discussion group afterwards for about an hour or so.
Did you go to the Comic-Con here and troll Kevin Sorbo about God is Dead?
We didn't. No. Well, a lot of our members were there at it. We were actually thinking of getting a CFI table, and I'm hoping if the Fan Expo comes back next year that we fork out the money to do that again, because I think there's a fair bit of common interest. It seems like a lot of sci-fi fans are also, there's a lot of overlap between sci-fi fans and the atheist community for some reason. And that's a whole other discussion, but it'd be fun, I think, to have a table there. And again,
sci-fi fans are nerds or geeks.
The soft proselytizing.
Well, yeah, most of us are either geeks or nerds.
Yeah, fair enough.
Which means we enjoy thinking.
Yeah.
And if you actually enjoy thinking, I mean, that's anti-theism right there. Theism is the encouragement of not thinking.
Yeah. That being said, I've met some fairly certain atheists who also enjoy not thinking.
Yeah,
certain in their disbelief as.
Fair enough.
it probably is less common. I think it depends on how you come to it. But
well, I'm quite certain that contradictions don't exist. So, for example, I'm quite certain there are no square circles. And to the same extent, I'm quite certain that there's no being who loves me and will torture me for eternity, only because that's nonsense.
Fair enough.
So I'm certain that nonsense doesn't exist. But I guess beyond that,
I can be certain of negatives, especially like, and I think the interesting thing about theism, the more specific the theism, the greater the degree of certainty I have that it's not true. When you start getting down into like the softest of soft deism, where it's like there was some sort of first cause that we don't understand, well, that's scientifically true at this point, right?
Yeah.
That we don't understand really what happened pre-Big Bang. There's a lot of theories, but
therefore, God.
Therefore, well, God. I'm not saying therefore God, but what I am saying well, is you almost have to be.
That's what like the quote-unquote soft deism.
Yeah, well.
You know, at some point, a guiding hand was involved.
Yeah, what started that everything in motion? I can be a lot more tolerant of, I should say tolerant, I'm tolerant of most people, but I can be a lot more accepting of the idea that there was something pre-Big Bang that set everything in motion.
Or that there could have been.
That there could have been, right? There, well, there also could have been a computer program and we're all existing in the Matrix, right?
Sure.
So that just set the rules in motion.
Simulation theory.
Yeah, right?
So, or Nozick's experience machine, as exactly. we used to call it before the Matrix came out.
That was a thing?
Descartes.
Yeah, they stole that. Well, Descartes' brain
demon,
in the vat,
right?
Yeah. That's the brain in the vat.
Descartes' demon trapping you in a dream, right? There's no way of being certain that that's not true. But again, sort of the softest of soft deism, that there was something, you know, I can, that's a flip of a coin really at that point. What happened at that point? Because we don't know. I think you start dealing with God of the gaps and God starts getting pretty small pretty quick. It's as soon as you start getting specific, then you can start having contradictions, and that's what I guess
that's where certain
that's where you can be certain of things not being true.
Yeah, because they argue against themselves.
Yeah. Again, though, like I can't be 100% certain we're not in the Matrix and it isn't just an illusion, as it were. Right? I can't be certain of that.
I've said before that I think that agnosticism is like. In a broad sense, the right way to look at things. But when it comes to like something like Christianity or Islam, we can be fairly certain that that's not true.
Yeah, fairly certain.
Well, yeah, but again, a Christianity, number of the assertions.
I almost never use the word Christian or Christianity anymore when I'm talking philosophically or about actual religion. I'll use it as a political group. I think Christians exist as a political group as an identity. But the diversity of idea.
Yeah,
like
there's
you
no
end up falling into that
belief.
The no true Scotsman fallacy or no true Christian fallacy pretty damn quick. Yeah. It's almost a useless term because as soon as you start talking about Christians as individuals or even as a group, there's no common set of belief. Well, there's that. I can't remember where the study came out of.
They
I think
do
it was,
all believe in a sky wizard of
but
some
they
kind.
Don't. That was the Pew. I think it was Pew. I'm 99% sure it was Pew Research, but it was a study that came out recently. 66% of people who identify as Christian believe there is a God. Think about that number
for
a second.
How does that work?
66% of people who self-identify as Christian believe
there is
some sort of God.
34% of the people didn't understand the fucking question.
Thinking that Jesus is not God.
34?
Yeah.
Wait.
Yeah, the 66 that didn't.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right.
But so it's.
I thought you said 44.
No, it's. So it's.
I can math, motherfucker.
So you have basically a third of those who self-identify as Christian who don't believe in the existence of a God. Right. So when you get down to that much of your core principle, the term becomes meaningless at that point, right?
Roughly 34% of them basically can't spell the state they live in.
Yeah.
Starts with an A and ends with an A.
In any case, I'm hoping that it's the 34% are the smarter ones, maybe. I don't know.
Wow, are you ever more optimistic than everybody else?
But then
the
how could they identify that? Like,
we're all pretty sure that those are the people that just didn't understand what
because
they were talking about.
Because it's in a lot of places, especially in the United States, but even in Canada, it's politically expedient to identify as Christian. And there's a lot of people who just don't think about it, right? Going to church at Christmas is what you do. Saying you're Christian is the box you tick off. And you, if you never think about it, you never think to change it.
Yeah.
Right?
Like so they identify as Christians even though they have no idea what they're not Christian.
It's like it's something you can be born into, like
well,
being
usually,
a Jew.
Usually it is, right? Most people are the religion they're born into.
That's how you find them, yeah.
Right? Like it's there's not a lot of people who were born into a and there are some, right? There's always the statistical outliers.
Cat Stevens.
Yeah, right? You have your Cat Stevens of the world, born Christian, converts to Islam. I'm sure there's one of the news stories that we're looking at talking about the person who was converted to Christianity from Islam that
He didn't actually convert.
Okay, fair enough. Never mind, different story then. There are people who have converted to Christianity from Islam. various other conversions that exist, but I don't think that, like, those are the statistical outliers. For the most part, people's religion is that what they're born into. So you continue self-identifying it. I think it's also interesting when you look at things like the Pew Research and various studies done on religious identity, you'll have atheist and non-religious often being separate categories, or religion, atheist and none be a different category.
Or atheist and agnostic.
Yeah. Atheist slash agnostic.
Well, whoever's non-religious being the other. Doesn't understand what
atheist is. Thought of by the larger non-atheist community as being the position that there is no God.
Right.
So being the belief that there is no God rather than being a lack of belief.
Yeah.
And I think that's widespread among the ignorant.
Atheism is a belief like not community. Playing golf is a hobby.
Sure. Sure it is. So, I mean, it's a garbage definition, but I think it's common.
Isn't that how definitions
like off
exist,
though?
Like, science exists outside of public opinion, but definitions don't. If someone defines a term as meaning something,
meaning
that
is
what
widespread
it means,
use.
Right? So,
well, as long as it's understood by a large community, that is the meaning.
Like
of
the word literally, which now officially can mean not literally.
Yeah, which can mean figuratively.
Yeah,
it can be used.
There's
as
all
an
sorts
intensifier
of definitions
now
that have changed over time, and I think what does and you know, there's lots of ways of saying, oh, is this hard atheism, soft atheism, agnostic atheism, certain atheism, all of those other categorizations.
The Dawkins scale of 7 or whatever.
Yeah, right. So
you don't like that.
We don't like the Dawkins scale. All right, I'm assuming that it's a parallel to the Kinsey scale.
But basically, it's, what is the scale?
Non-philosophers try to draw sharp lines.
Yeah.
It amuses the rest of us.
All right. In any case, I try to avoid that idea of clumping Christians into one group because it means virtually nothing from an actual what someone's religious position may or may not be. Yep. When you can have liberationist theology exist within the same blanket as the sort of the acquisition of wealth Christians, like this idea that you have within one umbrella, this idea that God will reward you with wealth and you should hoard money and good Christians are the richest Christians, and this idea of libertarian conservative Christians existing within the same tent as Jesus, or the idea of that makes the term virtually useless as far as what is someone's religious position.
Kind of meaningless.
And atheism has some of that too, right? Because atheism, atheism defines what you don't believe rather than what you do. Yeah. That being said, there are different sort of atheist philosophies, and putting objectivism and secular humanism under the same umbrella, like, yes, technically both don't believe in religion, like a religious figure, like technically both don't believe in a God.
The funny thing about objectivism, though, is that it's adhered to by the religious right in the United States.
Again, similar to the Christians who don't believe in God, don't understand what they're saying they believe in, right? Someone who's a quote-unquote conservative Christian viewing Ayn Rand as a hero is pretty ridiculous.
Paul Ryan?
A lot of them do.
Rand Paul.
Named after.
Yeah.
So
it takes all kinds. And again, we have within and a weird convoluted way back to the CFI topic again, but we have within the group a fairly wide variety of skeptics. I think most people within the group would be accurate when they self-identify as skeptic. Some of them are on the agnostic end of religious, but would still consider themselves religious. Other people probably are fairly certain about certain religious ideas or other forms of woo, but for the most part, their adherence to skepticism is pretty solid, and they can really identify with the secularism aspect of our mission, and we're certainly not going to say no, you can't come out and join us, because how else are we gonna help people? And I'm sure there's things I'm wrong about too, right? And I know there are opinions that I've changed by coming out to skeptics at the pub nights, right? And I've come in and we'll sit down and we'll get into some heated debates about various elements, and so not necessarily religious ones, but sometimes. And I'll find my opinions changing about stuff all the time.
Well, like Sam Harris, I found my opinion changing about free will. Just as Sam Harris is in that very same situation right now because of Dan Dennett.
Yeah, and I'm not. Yeah.
Got me. Yeah. Being open to change is a good thing. Mm-hmm. That's what being a skeptic is all about.
That's right.
So
being
would you
willing
say
to change with the,
the majority of the people in the CFI Regina group would identify as anti-theist as well?
Probably not. Atheists, for sure. I would certainly say you're probably more than 50% would self-identify as atheist. A lot would be identified by others as atheist, even if they don't take on that term for themselves. Certainly quite a few would be, I would certainly say that the portion that would self-identify as theist is in the small, is a minority of the group. As far as anti-theist goes, there's a couple.
There are a few for sure, because I'm one of them.
Yeah.
Ditto. Yeah. Yeah.
There's some, I don't know if that's certainly, I wouldn't put that in the majority though. I would say there's a certain plurality there that I would certainly say it's more than the two of you.
It's a percentage.
It is more than two.
Well, I am one as well. So that's three.
That's three. We got something.
Excellent. Four. All right. Four people. I didn't know all four of you are in the group. I should pay more attention to our membership.
This is a representative of CFI. Yeah.
Again, that's another one of those things though, too, is I'm not even that sure how I would define the term anti-theist. So as far as who self-identifies that way, I'll try and, I think labels are useful. Labels are really good shorthand for starting conversations.
Sure.
And then going, okay, so you use that label. I have an idea what that means. Let's talk for a bit and figure out how much overlap there is between our two points of view on what that term means.
It's a good way to start.
But like if someone says I'm anti-theist and how I define that term is I hate everyone who believes in religion and I think the government.
It's not matter, antimatter. Not at all. You know, theist, anti-theist. If we touch one, we fucking both annihilate each other.
I've met people who would self-identify as anti-theist and they believe in an atheist state where religion is outlawed, feel that people who are Christian should be forbidden from holding public office.
I think I've witnessed some things like that.
I think for the most part, those are straw men, right? Like they're not.
Yes,
those,
they are.
Those people exist as straw men a hell of a lot more than they exist in reality, but they do exist in reality.
Yeah, to an extent, yeah.
One of the problems of the modern world and the modern internet is all of the things that used to be straw men now turn out to be actual real people. There's just a very small number of them. But they do exist. So I have met people who that's how they define anti-theist.
Yep.
So I'm hesitant about putting that label
on
other people.
But even most people who identify as anti-theist are people who took the term from Hitchens.
Yeah.
And even those people, even Hitchens never always said that he would not actually abolish all religion if he had the ability. Yeah.
But he believed it was positively harmful.
Yes, that's
which
right.
is all the rest of us. Well, I shouldn't say the rest of us, because like you say, there are outliers.
But most of us.
But that's exactly what I believe, that religion is positively harmful.
It's basically the belief that, or not the belief, sorry, the stance of being against any organization that causes harm to its members or anyone else. And since every religion in its basis causes harm, I'm against every religion.
See, personally, I don't know if I would agree to that. I'm not sure if I certainly see religion having done a lot of harm in the world.
To cause more harm than they have done good.
Yeah, and I don't know if there is sufficient empirical evidence to back up that claim.
Sure there is. There was an excellent Intelligence Squared debate with, perhaps you've even seen it. It was with Stephen Fry and Hitchens.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Has the Catholic Church been a force for good in the world?
Yeah, for good or evil. So it's not religion in general. It's only the Catholic Church.
A specific
religious organization, in the perpetuation of the oppression of women, which is fully half the human race, it's rather difficult to say that they've done more good than harm. just on that alone, if you ignore everything else.
Every religion puts their followers on a pedestal above every other religion.
Yes.
Period.
Yeah. So do Ryder fans. Right? Like every organization
Although,
does that within their own
Ryder
group.
Fans don't quite have the power structure that religious organizations
you're right,
have.
But even atheists aren't immune to that sort of thing, right?
No, of course not.
Yeah. And you look at the status of women, we have you have conferences devoted to women and secularism where the keynote speaker is a white cis male. Who comes up and basically says, yeah. I don't even know why we're having this event. Yeah. You guys should be more grateful to how lucky you are are letting you do this.
It's like the Damon Wayans bit where he shows up at a white supremacist rally as a...
And the atheist community then rallies around. Some. Yes. Not all, right? So you then have... So again, we're not immune to that either. And when you start looking at things like the role of the Catholic Church... You can have a debate about what impact it had. It definitely had a negative one. Mm-hmm. But I don't know how much of that would not have existed had the Catholic Church not been there. Like to say the rampant misogyny that exists in Western society
I
think they would have.
It's a bit of a chicken and egg problem.
Yeah, it is a bit. And I think a lot of times it's religion. Again, I'm an atheist, right? I don't believe in religion myself, but yeah. I think religion gets both the credit and the blame for a whole lot of stuff that it shouldn't. Mm-hmm. It's the Catholic Church was a political organization and it was a unifying governmental body for white Western Europe. This idea that a bunch of people with a powerful military viewing an enemy that has resources they wanted and that they wouldn't have attacked and stolen those resources if there hadn't been religion, I think is putting too much credit at the foot of the Catholic Church. I think yes, this organization, this group of independent states, had they not had an organizing body over top of them, probably wouldn't have had the organizational ability to go launch that war.
I totally agree. But
what's the alternative?
Like the Warsaw Pact wasn't a church, and it was able to organize a bunch of independent. Well, they became not so independent, similar to organizations under the Catholic Church. NATO exists. Like you can have interstate and like international organizations that have a military cohesiveness to them, and humans like stealing stuff from each other. Like if we can take shit by force, we'll find a reason to do it. And religion sometimes makes a good excuse. I have the feeling, and maybe this is my cynicism about the human nature coming out, I have the feeling had religion not been there, they would have found another excuse. They would have then said, oh,
what
it's
you're
this
left
other
with
reason.
Is a common cause.
Yeah.
Some really unhealthy cause for religion, or in the absence of religion, that same cause would still cause the same sort of behavior.
Yeah.
In that case, you're still ending up with religion as the effect of an unhealthy cause.
I agree. Again, then we start coming back down to though, how much more negative came about because of the existence of religion? How much of that negative would have still been there? And
that's
how
just
much
it.
Of the positive too, right? There's no way of knowing. That's why I'm saying I'm somewhat agnostic on that topic. I don't think there can be enough empirical evidence because we can't recreate what the world would have been like had religion not existed.
That's true.
And I think there is some good that comes of religion, which again, I think, and the CFI is not the sole method of doing this.
Of course.
But I think there's other organizations that can come in and provide some of that good in the same way.
All of it, probably.
Hmm?
Probably all of it.
Yeah.
Everything that's good about religion, which is usually a sense of belonging to a group or whatever, can be accomplished in a myriad of different ways.
Even if you look at something like prayer, I think, and again, this is where CFI, we may not be the best place for that. virtually every single religion has some sort of cultural practice similar to prayer, whether it be prayer, meditation, inward focus. All of them have that, and more science now is showing that mindfulness, meditation is good for you. There is a healthiness to meditation. You can strip it of its religious elements, but I think there is scientific weight now behind the idea that that is good for you. And I think religion has provided a system by which that practice can be disseminated.
There's an excellent talk in TED called Atheism 2.0. I know you don't like it very much, but Atheism 2.0, and it's a talk about all of the good that religion has done, the sort of the sociological service that it does for us that we're missing without it, and how to account for that, for the ritual, for the community, and all of that.
One of my favorite authors, it's an author by the name of Robert Wright. I'd sort of fallen in love with his work like years ago when he wrote a book called The Moral Animal and then Non-Zero, talking about game theory and how game theory applies to evolution and how that progresses. But a few years ago, he put out another book called The Evolution of God. And it's a very interesting perspective because one of the things it looks at is how if you look at the arc of religious evolution, and obviously I don't think he doesn't take the approach that God has evolved over time, but humanity's perception of God certainly has. And for the most part, that progression, that evolution on how we perceive that entity has become more and more tolerant over time. Even when you look at a theological figure like Paul of Tarsus, who's done irreparable harm to, and you go back to the role of women in society, the misogyny that he perpetrated is mind-boggling. At the same time, he is also one of the key figures in this idea behind breaking down a lot of tribal and nationalistic barriers and ushering in a lot of this idea behind, and again, entirely self-interested, and certainly not a universalist humanitarian or humanist perspective, but basically this idea that as long as you're Christian, you're okay. It doesn't really matter what nationality you are, or where you come from. Are you Jew? Are you Roman? And that was unique. That was unique in that point in history. The world was ready for it. Yeah. And I think that idea, that meme would have spread wherever it rose, whatever religion it rose within. But I think when you look at how religion can have a positive effect, bundled up with all of the negative stuff,
but you still have all of the negative
stuff. You still do.
It doesn't make up for it. Like,
you can say that
Jacob Vera was negatives. A fantastic person. He was a homophobe and wanted to kill all the gay people. Same kind of thing. Just a little bit of an aside. Yeah. So it's not religion based, right?
You can say that all of the negative effects could have happened anyway, but then you also have to say that all the positive ones could have as well.
Most of them. And I don't think all of the negative things could have, and I don't think all of the positive things could have. I think
that's
a
fair.
Large portion, I think we overcredit.
But it's hard to know which are which. It's hard to
absolutely
know.
It is.
But the fact that these religions, these major world religions, are still pushing these agendas.
Yeah. They're political organizations, right?
And
they're self-interested political
things
organizations.
That we can, are specific negative things that have had a massive impact that we can attribute to religion. Like John
Islam.
Paul.
Or Islam.
Pope John Paul saying that.
Oh, Jesus.
saying that condoms caused AIDS.
Yep.
You know, how many millions of people have contracted HIV because of that? I mean, that's a pretty major negative impact.
Pope John Paul is also
a homophobe.
And
we can draw that direct
homophobe.
Conclusion.
Yeah, absolutely.
He was also a misogynist, homophobe.
Right.
Misogynist. You keep doing that.
Why do I put a hard G there?
By functioning retard.
I wouldn't say that high functioning, actually. Break
yeah,
time.
let's have a save. Save
okay.
break.
Save break?
Yeah. And then when we come back, we'll actually do some topics.
You can't fill your cup until you empty all it has.
So one thing you'd mentioned before the break, and it just sort of had me thinking over the break, and I know you have a list of topics.
But, that's fine.
About the stupidity of John Paul II and some of the horrible things he said and the impacts on it.
Right.
And I think, again, not to say religion is good, but I was thinking about Jenny McCarthy.
Oh, which is
yeah, you never want to start a sentence with that.
Like, there's some tissues in the bathroom.
No, different way of thinking about her. I'm thinking about her in the same way I think about Pope John Paul, and it's not that way. No church,
there's tissues in the bathroom.
No religion that exists around her, although religiously True. Devoted to her in some ways. How many? Like, again, it's that same level of harm. Mm-hmm.
It's the religion of celebrity. In a sense.
But if we start broadening the category of religion that big.
Well, but you can say that people follow her and believe everything she says.
Yeah. Well, celebrity is American nobility.
Yeah.
Right.
It's the same sort of thing over here in the West. So
but you have that within the skeptic community. Like, there's a lot of people who believe what Richard Dawkins says because Richard Dawkins said they don't understand the science. They haven't Absolutely. Bothered to learn. They're not skeptical about it. They are not critical thinking with regards to what he's saying. Critically thinking, rather. Sorry. But again, it's this idea of, and I know one of the topics you wanted to talk about later is the idea of. The fallacy of the argument from authority or false argument from authority, right? And I think that's not necessarily an issue with religion. That's an issue with having authority figures. And if you're broadening it that big, how would you try and evaluate the history of the human race without having authority figures? It'd almost be impossible.
There's nothing wrong with authority figures in and of themselves.
Right.
It's what you do with that authority.
Yeah. And the problem with like religious organizations like the Catholic Church is that they present their authority figures as though they are infallible people who are the ultimate word.
Well, I think the Catholic Church specifically has that as doctrine. And even that's only when the Pope is speaking in his papal voice or whatever. I can't remember the Latin.
Even a specific priest, say, who molests a child.
Yeah.
And there, I don't know any names off the top of my head, but there's numerous cases.
For sure.
The only reason that people allow their children to be with that person is because they are a religious figure.
Or football coaches. Or hockey coaches.
Or Michael Jackson.
Yeah. Like it's don't get me wrong. But it's the institutional power behind it that's the problem, right?
It's like, because they assign a certain amount of prestige or they forget that they're a human being because of X type of position. And football coaches have it too, which is another ridiculous thing.
Yeah.
Football. I've often heard it said that in the South, football is its own religion.
Yeah.
So,
but again, we as a species have power structures. We're like, I don't think you can.
But I
get away from that.
It all comes down to critical thinking.
Yeah.
Yeah, is what it always does.
And again, when you look at the course of human history, where has religion fallen in? I think what religion does is it provides, and I think there's two different arguments. Has it been a overall positive influence over the course of human history, and is it an overall positive influence now? I think it is completely subjective.
I don't know.
And I also think those are two very, very different.
I think there's
topics.
Direct action though. Like even Jenny McCarthy with her anti-vax propaganda hasn't had the impact in number of lives lost as, say, the Catholic Church or missionaries in third world countries that have promoted
She hasn't
the
told
idea
her,
that,
her millions of followers to go out and kill people either.
She also hasn't discovered the Big Bang Theory,
right?
Which the Catholic Church did. So, and that was as a direct result of funding astronomical research. It was as of a direct result of this mindset of trying to gain a greater understanding of God's creation. And it was a member of the clergy who first discovered an expanding universe because of direct funding from this organization that has done all of these other harmful things. When was that?
Because of a kind of oppression in which no one else was deserving or had access to education.
That was like except 70 for the clergy. Years ago?
Well, that's throughout the Dark Ages as well.
No,
right?
But like the Big Bang Theory, that's the human was history, like 70 years ago. Like we're not talking about 16th century. We're talking we're talking about 20th century now.
But religion is funded. Any sort of inquiry throughout. I mean, that's
yes.
Mm-hmm. So they've sort of had a monopoly on the whole thing.
Different religions have had it though too, right? So
sure.
And again, that's religion functioning as a government body. It's when you look at what its actual impact is on history, it's the religious belief, which specific form of superstition, magic, what flavor of Sky Wizard you have, has been really secondary as far as the impact it has on society. The impact it has on society is when it's functioning like a political body. And when it does that,
which is always,
which is, yes, anytime it's dominant, for sure, mm-hmm. which it really comes down to when you're evaluating its historical impact is how has that form of political body impacted the world? And I think we have better choices now. I think there are better options for all its flaws. You have, you know, World Health Organization, you have the United Nations, you have various international science councils. All of those things are now have grown to fill that role that religion had. I don't know if 500 years ago those organizations could have existed outside of a religious context.
No, they couldn't have.
So had religion not existed, that wouldn't have existed.
So
that's what it sounded like you were arguing for.
But
modern medicine used to use cranial drills to try to relieve headaches.
Yes.
Back when that was modern. So just because that's what used to happen, and from that we've evolved to using drugs and now understand, doesn't mean that the cranial drill was a good thing in and of itself. Not to the people that had their heads drilled.
Okay.
I don't know. I've heard it's like being high all the time. Yeah.
There is still cranial drilling, though.
Right, but not to relieve headaches specifically. It's to relieve...
Yeah.
Because they actually know what they're doing now.
True.
But and looking at religion the same, in what it did for society versus what it's doing now, what it did doesn't matter. It's what it's doing now that matters.
Okay.
When
you were bringing up the list, again, you got to go both ways then, right? Because when you were bringing up the list of negative things that it did, you were going largely historical.
Well, right, because that's what we were talking about at that time.
Right.
Okay.
Right. So if we're bringing it into present day,
right.
I'm probably more likely to agree with you that it's probably doing more harm than good. But even then, I don't know if I would go as far as being certain on anti-theism. I think
like cranial drilling, it's an idea that's run its course.
Well, throughout history, I wouldn't say it's more likely that it was doing some good back then, and now it's just extraneous. It's not the way I would view it. I mean, that's the way I was that's why I was bringing that up.
Okay,
throughout history, people who are educated, people who are advancing society, were necessarily religious. Because the religions insured that themselves.
Yeah. But I think, again, you have that's the egg.
It is a chicken and egg thing.
Right?
But
would they have been that educated without religion being there?
That's just it. Who knows?
Right.
But it's unfair to say, well, look, religion is actually the source of all of these advancements, you know, up to and including the Big Bang, say.
And how many did it keep down?
It's unfair. Yeah, it's unfair to say that wouldn't happen otherwise. It's unfair to say that religion had really anything to do with that at all. Perhaps religion stood in the way of that, was kind of an obstacle that we've actually overcome in thinking skeptically rather than being religious.
You look at a lot of the traditions of skeptical thought come back to religious thought, though. The history of skeptical thinking is very, very well rooted within apologetics.
Yeah, the Spanish Inquisition found a lot of them.
Yes, and again, you're being hypocritical, though, is what you're being, right? Because if you're saying this political organization that killed and executed political dissidents is the fault of religion, but you're saying the good that came about would have happened without the religion. It's, they're so intertwined, both the good and the bad.
Well, no, I mean, there's obviously been, you know, things like the Khmer Rouge in Cambodia. I mean, that wasn't religious based, and it was clearly far worse.
But, right.
You know, there's assholes in every outfit.
It's how is power.
The problem is power.
Yeah.
And authority, and religion is an excellent means to control.
For sure it is.
That seems to be how it's been used.
I would also say most societies that have either enforced religion, but also any society that represses it, seems to have the same problems. If you look at anywhere where religion is actively outlawed, you run into the same problems.
Well, is there a place where religion is
North Korea? It would be a prime example of that.
Yeah, well, I think that
it might be utopia, though. We don't know.
Again,
North Korea is every religion except ours is outlawed. And our religion includes our leaders of state being our religious figures, right?
How broadly are you defining religion then?
Well, don't
you don't
they
need
actually
to define it that,
that
broadly okay. for North Korea. Yeah,
they
I don't
actually
think.
Say that like the old leader
their
is
grand,
like
yeah,
God.
The grandfather is still a ghost. And
so, I think that's clearly a kind of theism.
Eternity.
Yes.
Yeah, it seems like theism to me. It's just...
It is definitely a kind of theism.
Okay, I'm just putting another extra bit in here afterwards. I'm not sure if you can tell by the discussion that we had going on, but it sounds a lot like Dave is letting the religious aspect of the crimes of people who did them in the name of religion, he's letting that go. Like the number of things that, like he said himself, that he thinks the Crusades would have happened anyway. And maybe we'll never know that one way or the other. But this idea that we can ignore, not ignore, but we can forgive any bad and give credit for good because we don't want to, I don't know what the motivation is here, in the name of balance for or something. It ignores the fact that people who follow religion are obviously more willing to do things in the name of their religion than people are separately. There's one point in the conversation where I said, priests are given control over children and molest them, or something to the effect. And Dave says, or football coaches or hockey coaches. And in a sense, he's right. Yes, these things do have a kind of secular analog, but on the other hand, it's not nearly as prevalent in hockey coaches or football coaches as it is in Catholic churches, in cases where religious leaders are given this kind of authority over children without a background check. In real life, we check up on people before they watch our children. Unless you're talking about a religious family and their priest, they just hand their child over to them. In schools, do background checks on teachers in general. There's all kinds of, you look into things, but the Catholic Church specifically hid. Like this is not something that comes from just secular life. This is because it would damage the church and the portrayal of their religion. It is a religious thing. It's not just a human nature thing. And I think there's sufficient evidence to demonstrate that, despite the fact that David seems to think that there isn't. I would urge anybody to who's interested in the subject, actually, to refer. I'll refer you to Reasonable Doubts podcast, episode 128, Inside the Mind of a Religious Sexual Abuser. It's quite an insightful episode. They're really smart guys who have a lot of insight into what's going on there. It's not an episode for the queasy, though. They talk about a lot of stuff that actually was discussed in a courtroom. And it's quite an uncomfortable subject, and is quite uncomfortable to listen to. But if you can make it through, it's really good. There's also an argument that he seems to make where it's hypocritical to blame religion for the bad things, but not give it credit for the good things. And I think Mike made a good point when he says that religion may be partially responsible for the good things, but we know that it's responsible for the bad things. And we don't know that the bad things would have happened. The one point is brought up that it was Catholic Church. It was a member of the Catholic Church or something who came up with the Big Bang Theory. And I looked this up. And yeah, it absolutely is true. It's I had never heard it before this discussion with David. But it's true that the Catholic Church, a member did discover the Big Bang Theory. But the thing is, the evidence points to that. So eventually, that would have come about anyway. I think it's a Penn Jillette quote that says something like, if everything that humanity knew was destroyed and we had to start over, eventually different religions would come about. But scientific facts would simply be discovered because the truth doesn't change based on what you believe. And I think that's right there is a prime example of it. Like, yeah, okay, in this case, it was a religious person who discovered the Big Bang Theory, but that doesn't mean that the Big Bang Theory required a religious person to discover it. It is where the evidence points. An expanding universe would have been discovered, and that's all there is to it, because that's what that's factual. So to say that we need to give credit to religion for that, or for any other discovery that it happens to be responsible for, is kind of giving it credit for something that it had no control over. Like, yes, we still like to give individuals credit for discovering things that hadn't previously been discovered. But to pretend that it never would be discovered without that person or that organization is kind of disingenuous, I think. There was just two other things I thought of. First, when we first came back from break, David said that my comments about Pope John Paul and his responsibility for the AIDS epidemic in Africa is comparable to Jenny McCarthy's anti-vax following. And I made the mistake of calling them both religions. At the same time, we vilify Jenny McCarthy. We point out that she's a lying sack of crap and is spreading misinformation. And we say that people shouldn't follow her. So in the same respect, I say that about Pope John Paul. I still think that it's a belief thing. It's easier to convince people of something if you tell them that God wants them to do it. That right there makes it religious. In the same breath, Jenny McCarthy uses people's children to scare them into agreeing with her. So she uses a different tactic, but it's still fear. I guess what I'm getting at here is that this comparison to Jenny McCarthy is not in a defense of religion. It's simply pointing out that there are parallels, and it doesn't really speak to the fact that to the en masse kind of spread of misinformation that the Catholic Church or many churches is quite responsible for. I don't intend to take advantage of the situation after the fact, and I have the chance to review this, and David is not here to defend his position. I'm just, these are just some of the things that I thought of while I was listening to it. I guess I'll just leave this conversation for you guys to listen to. I enjoyed talking to David, and I actually am more frustrated listening to him than I was actually discussing this with him. It was a great conversation, and it was fun to be a part of. Okay, I think we've come as far as we can with this discussion.
Okay.
So I'm going to bring up the topics list.
Our topic for today, eh?
that's right. Of you. Saudi blogger and activist sentenced to 10 years and 1,000 lashes for insulting Islam.
All right.
Yeah, that was
Raif
awesome.
Badawi, I'm probably saying that totally wrong, was also charged to R1 million.
It's about $267,000.
That's right. Yeah, $267,000.
That was after he was initially sentenced to, I believe it was like 600 lashes and 7 years in jail.
Yeah,
and so appealed. They got thrown out, thrown out on appeal, and
then
the second new trial. We fucked up. We forgot to give you an extra 3 years and 400 more lashes.
Let's make it worse.
So that's bad, but. There's a woman, I can't remember her name.
Yes, that article just came out today.
Yeah. What did this guy actually do?
Oh, he has a blog that promotes dissent, basically. He allows people to criticize the kingdom. I don't think it actually even criticizes Islam specifically.
Well, the kingdom
but
of
the,
Islam.
The kingdom of Saudi, because it's a kingdom.
Well, that fell under the blanket of the new harsh anti-terror laws the Saudi government is bringing in, isn't it?
Oh, it very well could be.
I think it was part of the same sort of blanket legislation like the Patriot Act in the States.
Right. I guess I got a quote here out of this article. He is a prisoner of conscience who is guilty of nothing more than daring to create a public forum for discussion and peacefully exercising the right to freedom of expression.
And the only reason that he's being sentenced like this is because he didn't forsake, I think it says it right in that article that you're reading.
I'm not reading the article. Oh, I'm reading my notes.
Sorry. Right in the main article about that, because he didn't forsake the religion and he still has a blog that's basically against the base religion.
Oh, so he's still in the religion. And
he never...
Yeah, so he's not charged with apostasy.
Yeah, exactly. I was going to say, whereas if he had actually gotten out of the religion, okay, well, now we can whip the shit out of him for apostasy.
This woman that married a Christian that the article just came out today. I don't know her name. No. I haven't looked at the article too closely, but she was sentenced to death because she quit being an...
There's not some way they can rape her better out of that or something?
No, apparently not. It's just death.
Oh, okay.
No, because there's a Canadian connection there, isn't there? Like he's, or American.
Oh, it could be.
I can't remember if it's Canadian or American that he's tied to. And there's this huge outcry in the States trying to get Obama involved. So obviously it's American then. Where the husband might be American or have dual citizenship. And because she gave up Islam for Christianity, she's being sentenced to death. Because, you know,
which is
because Muhammad is that paranoid, I guess.
Well, that's the Quran's rule about apostasy is you must be killed.
But it's not when it comes to the other Abrahamic faiths. The Quran specifically says you're good as long as you remain one of the peoples of the
book. Oh, is that right?
Yeah, you're fine as long as it's Christianity or Judaism. As long as you don't convert to polytheism, you're fine.
I wonder.
Yeah, Christians and Jews are get special treatment under Islam.
If you become a Hindu,
then you're in trouble.
You're done.
It's polytheism. Yeah.
Yeah. Usually, anyway.
Polytheism is.
Or
bad.
If you're in a polytheistic relationship, where you're of one and somebody's of the other.
Yeah, I don't know how that would work. But yeah,
which doesn't make sense because it's still the same basis. That's why they get special treatment, right?
Yeah, I think the idea. For the tolerance towards Christianity and Judaism is it's the same God, just different practices, and that the Christians and the Jews just haven't accepted the final message yet.
Yeah. And isn't that really disingenuous? I mean, really?
Well, yeah.
The whole notion, well, we actually worship the same God. Well, no, look, the God who had a son isn't the same God as the God who didn't have a son. And that's rather important. It informs the entire religion of Christianity. So the notion that the Islam God, the Muslim God,
again,
is the
in
same.
Islam, they still believe Jesus existed, and they in Islamic belief, Jesus was just a prophet,
and Jesus, not the Son of God,
and never claim. And even in the Christian Bible, it's he never claims to be the Son of God. It's always the people who come after that claim that, right?
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
The Islamic message is actually probably more in line with everything right up to the end of the Gospels.
It might be, but I think the point stands that they're not the same God. They're not the same religion. The God who had a son is not the same as the one who didn't.
Well, they're all thick.
They did start.
So I don't know how you define that, right? Like it's
supposedly, and I'm just quoting, like I'm just using off the top of my head information. The branch off happens at Abraham. And that's when Muslims claim that's where they're...
Well, it's the Isaac Ishmael.
So it never gets as far as...
No, but they in Islam, Jesus is still one of the prophets.
Yeah.
He is one of the prophets of Islam. And Islamic belief basically is that they are the true continuation of the religion of Abraham.
Right.
The God that came to Abraham was the same God that came to
Muhammad.
And
the Christian religion Gabriel is a misguided religion.
Where's all the smiting?
There's lots of smiting.
Mostly the Old Testament.
You know, actually, I've got a whole list of...
Where is the current smite?
I've got a whole list of Quran quotes that talk about killing people. But they're all the disbeliever. They're not... None of them say...
The people of the book are not considered disbelievers.
Right. Yeah.
The idea is the people of the book still believe in Allah. They don't call... Even if they don't call him Allah.
It's the same.
They still believe in him. They've just misinterpreted some of his words, some of his instructions, which is the same idea.
It's interesting.
But, yeah. Like within Christianity, you have a lot of that same thought process too.
I wonder where... I mean, I don't know what this... what the ruling was for this woman who married the Christian, except that she's supposedly sentenced to death. I'm not sure where the basis for it comes from. But,
well, find me any sort of Christian, Jew, or Muslim who also, you know, doesn't wear polycotton blends. And that's also forbidden.
That's right.
Too,
yeah, that's right.
I guess there are some that usually
doesn't eat shrimp or
Orthodox.
Yeah,
because none of them are paranoid believers.
Well, yeah.
Well, some of them are, though. They just pick and choose which parts they're
that's
being
right.
paranoid.
Right. So they're not true believers of every word in the book.
You can't be because it's all there's so many contradictions.
Exactly.
Just, right. Yeah. The contradictions and hypocrisy
in
the book. I get it.
Completely. You can't be a true believer of any of the Abrahamic faiths because they're so internally inconsistent.
Part of this Saudi blogger that I wanted to question was the idea is. Freedom of expression universal. I saw one blog post, I believe it was in the Huff Post, that discussed this, that said specifically that freedom of expression is a universal right. And I'm...
like George Carlin said, they're not rights if they can be taken away.
Yeah.
They're privileges.
Rights exist as part of a social compact, right? Like there's no inherent... magic that makes rights exist.
Yeah, that's it's a social thing.
It's the split between the legal positivists and the legal naturalists. Yeah. It's an issue in philosophy whether rights are a social construct or whether there's such a thing as natural rights.
If there are such a thing as natural rights, they only can be enforced through social contract.
Sure.
Right? Sure. So
it's something a legal positivist would say.
Even if you take your most basic right to life, if you're in a group of 100 people, 99 of them have red hair and one has blonde hair, and the 99 redheads say, hey, we should kill people for being blonde. Even the most basic right to exist doesn't exist if the 99 redheads all say, let's kill this guy. I should say, maybe it exists, but it can't be enforced.
Yeah, that's right. So it's still a right. But it's not being enforced by society.
Again, I would say that becomes a semantic argument at that point, right?
So. It's a really difficult issue.
whether there's inherent rights only really matters if there is a God. If there's no God looking out and keeping score,
then it basically all comes down to people.
Yeah.
People who are interested in natural rights generally are theist.
Yeah.
But a number of people just think we can derive them a priori, straight out of reason.
I'm certainly open to the idea that you can come up with what they should be via reason. I think a utilitarian argument can certainly be made for most of the rights that...
That's empirical, though,
generally,
utilitarianism. So even that's after the fact.
Yeah. You can... If you get down to the truest root cause, imperialism, like not surface, utilitarianism, not surface utilitarianism, that, you know, just path of least resistance, but like going going back, peeling the onion back enough layers to the true utilitarianism of what's the overall greatest good, you're starting to get a lot more a priori rights that would sort of be extruded from that thought process, I think.
Perhaps. I wouldn't call them a priori, though.
That's fair.
It would still be empirical. It would still be viewing what well-being seems to be best.
TLDR.
You know? TLDR.
Okay.
That's why I'm here.
John Rawls is a good read, yeah. actually. A Theory
it's
of
a
Justice.
Heavy.
Yeah.
It is a little bit heavy, but he talks about deriving rights from behind the veil.
Yeah.
In the original position. And that's really rather interesting. There's a lot of things he would say that people behind the veil, that is, with no knowledge of their own race, of their own social standing and so on, there are a lot of things that we would unanimously agree to. And those are our rights. And I think that's a rather interesting position to have. There are a number of things we would all agree to, if only we weren't idiots.
See, I would even still say, though, that is informed by a form of utilitarianism. That is still informed by I'm looking out for my own best interest from behind the veil.
Mm.
What I look out for what causes the greatest good.
It is
from behind the veil.
It's those things that are unanimous in that sense. So yes, I'm only looking out for my own interest when I say, well, we should all have a right to property so that no one can steal from one another. And we would all agree to this because we all want to have property that no one steals from us. So I'm still looking out for my own interest, but it's something we would all agree to.
Yeah.
And that makes it a sort of universal thing. I think that's right. The whole point.
Yeah, no, I agree. Like I certainly would have definitely appreciated it. And I know it's actually funny that you bring up John Rawls. One of the only times I've ever, like the Saskatoon CFI group has been really instrumental in supporting the Regina one, but I've only had a chance to go to some of their meetings on fairly rare occasions. And one of the few that I got to was a 3-hour long lecture and discussion all about John Rawls' Theory of Justice. So it was really really fascinating.
That would be intense.
Yeah.
There was a professor from the U of S that came and did the presentation, and then it just opened up into a discussion, and it was really, really fun. And similar to tonight, I was the guest cool. and also greedy for time and got into this great big discussion with the professor while other people just sort of sat there and watched us talk. It was fun.
No,
the free speech being universal.
Well, yeah, being a non-philosopher and a blue-collar nut job.
You're actually a philosopher. You just don't have a degree in it.
Yeah.
I'm not a fan of people needing degrees to be philosophers. I think it's a mindset, not a set of credentials.
Maybe my mindset is not quite so philosophic. When I thought of the drummer from Scorpion being arrested for a month because he mooned people and called allegedly ranted about uneducated Muslims and covered his nose when he saw Pakistani and Afghan passengers near him.
It's the Scorpions. That's all I got to say.
I thought it was similar in, I mean, not nearly as highbrow, obviously, as the Saudi blogger.
Can they arrest the rest of them?
But
hey, man, they will rock you like a hurricane.
I live in Saskatchewan. That's okay.
Great, I thought, now I have that in my head, you fucker.
Here I am.
That's totally, that's the song for this episode.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure it is.
That's so old, you don't even need permission.
No, yeah. That's right. It may as well be classical music.
You could just play it. Nobody cares.
You have to classify it as music. Okay, that's
so. What's the question?
Well, I just thought it applied to the freedom of expression being universal thing. Like, okay, yeah, one guy's a blogger who's actually pretty highbrow, but the other guy's just a douchebag who mooned a bunch of people. It's still freedom of expression.
Yeah.
How does?
I'm absolutely fine with both.
Yeah, me
personally.
Too. Yeah, me too.
You know, could they be both completely free activities? Absolutely.
And I think any society that punishes expression that doesn't specifically promote harm to others. Is
cause harm. Was
this guy? I'm glad you used the word harm instead of hate.
Yeah, yeah. Like,
yeah.
Was the drummer from the Scorpions claiming that him moaning people was some form of artistic expression? Or
no, I think he just was drunk and
he was just like fuck those guys. And, yeah, fuck hey, look those at my guys. Ass.
Yep.
Oh, okay.
Although
that's still all right.
He claims he didn't do it.
Okay.
But I mean,
he's so he was really fucking drunk.
Yeah. So he was pretty drunk.
All right. Oh, good for him. Insurance got a reputation.
That's right.
I
well played, sir.
I think the benchmark or the high water line or whatever metaphor you want to use on free expression should really come down to encouraging direct harm. I think even here, it's the other end of the spectrum here. We're certainly on the more liberal end of the spectrum, but even in Canada, we have laws that enforce restrictions on speech,
hate speech laws, and
that tend to limit it to, I think, a greater degree than needs to happen. As much as I really despise the Westboro guys. And they're horrible, horrible people. I think there's greater harm done by making that illegal.
Exactly.
Good segue.
Well, and you have, what's the idiot from Saskatchewan? I can't remember his name.
You're going to have to narrow it.
Bill Walcott.
Bill Watcott.
Watcott. Bill Watcott.
Wetcott.
What?
What?
Watcott.
Watcott?
What?
Watcott.
What?
Caught.
Of all of the charges that have been laid against him, I think maybe one has actually been where I would draw the line, because it actively incited violence and actually was specifically promoting violence against a group.
Okay.
But most of the other stuff, as much as I disagree with someone saying all of those awful things, I think you do more harm than good by forcing it into the shadows and darkness.
I think that
turns it into
anything. And my wife is a big advocate of this, because I still use the word retard in the proper context, meaning idiots, not meaning mentally handicapped.
Not meaning handicapped.
Because I have an autistic 4-year-old, so she gets really upset when I use the word retard.
Yeah.
And I can't help it, because I get called it by all my friends all the time, so it's just stuck in my head.
Yeah, blame your friends, motherfucker.
No. Fucking retard.
But and what she said to me, which I ignore for my purposes, but which stands to reason for that, is you can still have your anti-hate speech laws, but everything that you want to say, you can still say just by thinking through what you're going to say and using better discourse.
Better language.
Better language.
Yeah, no, that's actually...
You can get the exact same thing across.
So then, basically, then it's a law that punishes the uneducated rather than the educated. So you can be just as hateful, but as long as you're educated, it's okay. If you're not educated, then you should go to jail.
Nicely put.
Well, it's kind of how the system works anyway.
That is how the system works. I don't think that's good.
No.
Right?
That is, like, no.
But, okay, so if there's a guy standing on a soapbox in the middle of the street, and he's advocating for... Puritan Christian views where the woman stays at home.
Yeah.
And if he's using well thought out English, I don't mean just educated, but just more courteous words, that's fine. If he's saying the fucking woman's place is a fucking kitchen, get the bitch back where she belongs, if he's using words like that in public, yeah, he should be stopped. And I know that we kind of disagree because they're just words.
Yep.
But a parent still has a right to their children gets media or
when an imam is screaming that from the steps of the church on a podium.
Okay, so it's the swearing that you object to, because you don't think your kid should be exposed to that.
No,
language.
No, it's that was just a quick thing off the top of my head.
Right.
I for one, the whole swearing thing, I could give a shit.
Yeah.
Obviously,
so what part of it makes that? What part of that makes that so heinous that you feel it validates the government coming in and telling him that he's not allowed to say?
Because anything that could push people to violence, like you were saying before.
Catcher in the Rye killed John Lennon. It pushed someone to violence.
You know, I don't get that from that book at all.
Just like how do you say what can push them into violence or what can't?
I think if it can be reasonably interpreted as an assassin.
And if that guy on the soapbox says if she don't go to the kitchen, beat the shit out of her. Yeah. That's where it crosses the line for me. But for me, I think that line needs to be a lot more specific about where the incitement of violence.
Right. Well, I'll agree with that. But I was just trying to throw that really quick without.
And like for Watcott, there's only
really just hashing this out right now.
In Watcott, there's only really one, and it's ironic too. The one that I think like, and again, my opinion doesn't matter.
Liberty,
kill all the faggots.
Yes, the song when he took the song "Kill All the Christians" because he took a pre-existing song that you can buy in Saskatchewan called "Kill All the Christians." He printed out the lyrics and the only thing he did is he replaced the word Christians with faggots. So you can buy the song "Kill All the Christians," and that's legal and that's fine.
What is that?
It's a song. It's a heavy metal song from some like metal band in the States called "Kill All the
Really?
Yeah. So he took the lyrics to a song called "Kill
All the
Christians."
I've never heard of this.
And he replaced the word Christians with faggots. That's
fascinating.
And then he handed that out. And I do think that crosses the line.
In both cases?
Yeah, I think it does in both cases.
That's good.
What's interesting, though, and this is, I'd almost make it less.
We're all looking up.
Yeah, everyone's phone comes up. I'd almost have Watcott's being less.
No phone so far this evening.
Because what Watcott did, and I feel like I'm defending all of their shitty arguments and shitty positions tonight.
Deicide. Of course it is.
What he did is he published this pamphlet that replaced the word. He put a little asterisk beside it with a web address. And if you go to the web address, it basically says, how come everyone's okay with this "Kill All the Christians" song, but not okay with the pamphlet you just read?
Okay, I'm going to cut it off there. There's still another hour and a bit of conversation that I'm going to finish editing and call bonus content. I'm currently working on a setup for how to supply bonus content to anyone who donates. So if somebody donates to the show, I'll figure this out and I'll send a link to the bonus content right away. If you want to keep up with what's happening on the show, check us out on Twitter at BrainstormPod, on Facebook at facebook.com/BrainstormPodcast. Or you can check us out on brainstormblog.net. You can help us out by giving us a rating and writing a review on iTunes or Stitcher. Or if you want to donate, we have a donate button on the sidebar of our website. You can find all the relevant links to this episode in the show notes. If you want to contact us for any reason, comments, criticisms, suggestions, or accolades, just email us at mail@brainstormblog.net or click the contact page and fill out the form. A couple shout-outs on this episode. On Facebook, Dan Banesh, Stephanie Drew, and Ezekiel Levy. Thanks for liking the page. On Twitter, Barry Darwinian, at Nardi12, Maximum Atheist, Anthony Tucker, Got Proof, Chris Deere, Hapless Pete, Artie's Party 1, Giggly Atheist, Giggly _ Atheist, Mandy Speak, Florida Girl, Roy Alexander Graham, IAIB Network, Quality Rising, George Reyes, African Burial Ground, Mr. Atheistic, Fred Lundgren, Complete History, Lee Phillips, Michael Barnett, AS Podcast, Savoy Rochelle, Alan Peacock, Elfwitch 5, The Villain 66, Atheist Detective, James Ryan Daly, God Complex Show, Miranda Celeste Hale, The Human Mirror, Religious Truth, David Hume Quotes, CFI Regina, Grandpa's Go American, David KCCO, Ms. Atheist Pants, Mark Aaron, Daily Plato Quote, Always Right, Steve Taylor, Zach's Mind, Carnal Nature, Troll Hands, Overlord, Michael Sherlock, and Keith Lowell Jensen. Thanks for the follow, fave, or retweet. And finally, the podcast shout-out for this episode goes to two podcasts that I'm new to listening to but really enjoy, and they're done by the same guy, Thomas and the Bible and Atheistically Speaking. Thomas does both, though I think for Atheistically Speaking he has a partner in crime, and they discuss things within the atheist movement and interview different people, prominent atheists, and they discuss how different ideas impact the movement as a whole. The last one I listened to was a two-parter with Greta Christina, and it was really interesting. Thomas and the Bible is exactly what you think it is. Thomas reads the Bible and comments on it. It's, well, it's almost totally uninteresting because the Bible is a boring-ass book. But Thomas makes comments, and he's quite funny, and sometimes actually makes it bearable to listen to, despite how horribly boring the Bible is. So that's it. That's all the shout-outs for this episode. Thanks, and thanks for listening, and I hope you can join us next time. Thanks again to David Richards from CFI Regina for coming on the podcast and talking to us. Music for this episode is Satellite by Rise Against.
We're really professional about this. Everybody just keeps talking, so Corey Kears
wasn't worth the squeeze there, man. Sorry.
Gong show of a podcast.
And don't worry about dead air and stuff. Corey is just an excellent editor.
Perfect.
Gumby doesn't get to actually say anything.
Who?
Yeah. That's right. That's right. I was thinking.
No, you weren't.
No, I was accidentally.
What was that for you? How about if you donate, we won't come to your house?
See, a live show would require a listener, a listenership, and we're all here.
That's true.
I'm glad this was a productive use of my Saturday.
It's funny and sad.
But mostly sad.
Who's going to hear this? Our moms, mostly.
Right. Your mom should come out to Skeptics at the Pub.
Yeah.